Welcome back, and it's time for our first segment here on Breakfast Show. And today we will be talking about youth and entrepreneurship and means of helping them in starting a new business in terms of labor marketing, as well as the various improvements that could be added to their business and economic empowerment. And joining us right now in the studio to shed more light on that topic is Mr. Abdulrahman Magdi. He's a writer as well as an entrepreneur expert. Welcome with us and good morning.
Good morning. It's a pleasure to be here.
Good morning, Mr. Abdulrahman.
Good morning to you.
Now let's start by defining what is entrepreneurship, because so many people don't really understand the definition. How would you define it to us?
Yeah, entrepreneurship is defined as the practice and the skill set needed for people who want to start and grow their own businesses. So the word entrepreneur, it comes from the French, and it actually into two segments, which are the ones who start enterprises or the ones who start companies.
Yes.
And like one of the things that we did, we tried to figure out in the Arabic culture, an Arabic word that corresponds to entrepreneurship. And we couldn't get any close to that, but I mean, like, there are some words that expresses being self-reliant, independent, and the ability to build things on your own. So entrepreneurship is the practice of building businesses.
Okay.
Now, Mr. Abdulrahman, now, in terms of our youth, how can we help them start a business, especially that usually they have a low budget?
Yeah. I think the good thing is that startup entrepreneurs usually start with a very low budget.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the good thing also is that we can look at most of the success stories that's very popular around the world globally and also in Egypt, because like in the recent year, we started having some local success stories as well. If we look at the Microsoft, the Apple, all these companies, we know that they started in the garage. So the good thing about entrepreneurship is that you can start from anywhere. And it becomes a matter of the skill sets and the ability to build, move step by step to be able to build and scale the business. Okay. So for Egyptian youth, the good news is now we have the internet. Now we have like changes in the structure of how business is being conducted. Now we have more openness from the bigger businesses to work with the smaller businesses. And now we have like smaller opportunities that exists in the market, which entrepreneurs can take advantage of. Of course, it's not an easy process. There is lots of steps and lots of challenges along the way, but we can say that the opportunity exists for those who can get themselves involved with the network. Because if we talk about it step by step, if I get the idea or I have the passion or I have the dream of starting my own business, first thing I need to do is that I need to hang out with the people who are starting their businesses. So if I have to find, if I'm an Egyptian youth and I want to start my own business, I have to find where are the people who are starting their businesses hang out.
Yes.
And you can find lots of events, lots of clubs, or you can join other youth who are starting their own businesses.
Online, of course.
Yes, online and offline. There's lots of events taking places. There's lots of hubs that's starting, that's called startup hubs. And like if you use even like Google, you can figure out some of these hubs that exists in Cairo and also in other governorates around Egypt. So if you hang out with the right group of people already starting their own businesses, you will be involved with the events, the right events that will equip you with the skills, with the network. And then you have to get the idea. Once you have a solid idea that actually touches your own passion, by then you can really start taking the first step. Searching for your co-founders, the guys or the girls that I'm going to start the business with. I can start assessing the financials. I can start looking at building my marketing plan and my business plan. Probably I would need funding. I would like hire a couple of people, get my first office, scale, get my first clients, and keep moving until I'm able to expand a business. And the good thing is that if you look at the past 5 years, there are at least four Egyptian companies that were able to raise funds from outside Egypt in more than $1 million. So Egyptian youth who started businesses in the past 5 years, they were able to get external funding of the amount of, I mean, external funding like international funding from major investment companies in the UK, in Europe, and even in the US. These Egyptian entrepreneurs, they were just like me and you, and they started up the exact same way that I just told you, hanging out with the right crowds, like being open to learn new skills, engage with the right crowd, work on an idea, be flexible to pivot and change the direction. And by carrying all these steps and enjoying the process, eventually we'll be able to build and scale a great company.
Okay, perhaps what distinguishes startups from other types of business is that you can cut down the number of staff and you can actually start up on your own. And I have seen personally so many people who started just on their own and they started their online business, and that was what distinguished them from other types of business. For example, I've seen people working in the field of jewelry, making jewelry and marketing exactly. their jewelry online. So how do you see what characterizes entrepreneurship from other types of business?
Yeah, I mean, I like to define as entrepreneurship. I like to say that entrepreneurship is a quite a generic word for people who want to start their businesses, but there are different types of businesses.
Okay.
There is a lifestyle business and there is a startup business.
Mm-hmm.
So a lifestyle business is something that depends on my own lifestyle. If I'm like a jewelry designer, for example, and I think that I used to work at a specific shop and I want to start my own business.
Mm-hmm.
And the way I think about this, and by the end of the day, what distinguishes a lifestyle business from a startup business is how I think about it. I might have the attitude is that I want to just build this as my own business. So other than giving my time for employment, I'm gonna work in this business and keep it a small business to a lot of extent, have my own shop, and this is gonna be my lifestyle business. On the other hand, startup business is something that I design for growth. So startups usually have innovation, have lots of innovation, and have massive potential. So in a lifestyle business, I'm gonna design like 5 pieces and sell it per month, and I'm gonna make X amount of money. And that's how I think about it for the next 5 years. For a startup business, I would like to write down the process of designing this jewelry, and I want to organize a production line of the jewelry, and I want to scale this globally. I wanna sell all around the world, and I have no ceiling to the amount that I would like to sell. So these are some of the decisions that entrepreneurs have to take early on. Would I like to go for a lifestyle business, or would I like to go for a startup business? Actually, both can be started in a low budget, but startups would require more effort, would require more knowledge, and also would require external capital, because eventually, even if I started with 2 employees and I proved the concept, so I built a product, for example, a technology product, a product where people can purchase like anything online, for example. And by then I started with 2 people, 2 employees, and I arrived at the area that there is demand that I have to scale and I have delivery to handle. So by then I need external funding.
Exactly.
So startups requires external funding. It needs lots of other different types of support. So startups is high growth, and this might not be suitable for everybody.
Okay.
Because it's quite challenging. A lifestyle business, on the other hand, and like one of the things that I see, and actually I applaud lots of ladies for that, is that especially ladies, they get into the lifestyle business and they do excellent. And some of them actually scale this and make it much more bigger businesses. So a lifestyle...
And it's even more convenient for women who have children or are working on other jobs. So
exactly.
It's more convenient.
Especially, I mean, stay-at-home moms who usually are not employed, they usually start... Lots of them in Egypt right now, they are starting lifestyle businesses and they're even to shift and to scale these businesses.
Okay.
Like, and also ladies are also starting startup businesses. There are some of the best startups in Egypt are actually started and led by ladies as well. So it's like a decision that you have to take, when I go for a lifestyle or I go for a startup. And actually I can shift. I can start as a lifestyle and then I shift at the right moment into this is a startup. I'm going to open up, I'm going to hire people. And by then I decide to get myself out of the process and just oversee and design the process and make sure we're able to grow tremendously.
Now, in terms of the startup business, these, they need, as you said, external finance. And although recently, like during this month, there were a lot of advertisement from certain national banks that encouraging the youth, come and do your own startup business and we'll finance you. But still, do you feel that the banks in Egypt, especially the interest rate, is really helping the youth in terms of taking a loan and starting their own business? Because usually the interest rate is quite high.
Well, like, I know about the initiatives of lowering the interest rate to 5%, which is an interesting initiative, but I think that goes for more established businesses, because the banking sector do have requirements, and these requirements are not fit for someone who's just starting a business. So you need, like, they're going to be requested at least 3 years of like fully furnished accounting, which is not going to be available for like a company that's just starting out.
Mm-hmm.
So there are some complexities that comes into that, like dealing with banks,
mm-hmm.
and also banks are risk sensitive. So it just makes the startup, the early stage businesses are not very favorable choice for them to get involved with. But the good thing is that the startup in the industry, actually there is, especially in the US, which is something also that's arriving in Egypt, like quite slowly, but it is starting to evolve with time, is that there is a finance industry that works in the startups. There is a venture capital. This is an industry
mm-hmm.
that's specialized in hunting the ideas that would have a potential for growth.
Mm-hmm.
That things like Facebook, things like all these small businesses that have the potential to grow,
mm-hmm.
these investors would be able to kind of invest $100,000 today, and probably in 6 months, this $100,000 would become a $1 million or $10 million, and in some cases can like get a 1,000x if the company is successful and growing properly. So probably, if we want to look at this strategically, we would look at the possibility of finding the right investment vehicles for this startup stage, because it requires a different mentality, a different risk appetite. And around the world, the tools that entrepreneurs can use to develop and grow their businesses have been emerging. And the biggest trend right now, which I think it's suitable to the Egyptian mentality, is the crowdfunding,
mm-hmm.
which is basically that you can submit your idea and you can allow other people to invest in your business.
Mm-hmm.
So I think this is an excellent opportunity for Egyptians, because lots of Egyptians would have a small amounts of capital. They usually even put it at the banks, or they invest in real estate. Like if we tell them that there are existing startups that needs cash to scale, and these actually are highly qualified individuals running these startups, and they have been doing this for 3-5 years, and right now they need 500,000 Egyptian pounds, and the potential for them in 2 years to reach this amount. And you can actually each contribute like 20,000 pounds or 100,000 pounds, and you own an equity in this company. So like potentially a tool like that would allow entrepreneurs in Egypt and would give them access to something that would like help them source the right capital for their companies, and also would give an alternative investment opportunities to those with a small amounts of capital who would like to invest. So I think when it comes to the banking sector, maybe if we think about it differently of empowering the emerging vehicles for investing in startups and in small businesses, this might be a good option, because I'm not sure how the banking sector would get into investing in startups. Even like this didn't happen in the US.
Mm.
This didn't happen like in a lot of other kind of countries around the world. The banks are still very risk sensitive, so
yes.
they usually do not engage in a very early stage of startups.
Okay. How do you see entrepreneurship when it comes to affecting the Egyptian economy?
Well, I think, to be honest, I think that's how, like, where the Egyptian economy should be going. And it should be going way more stronger.
Mm.
Because if you look at Egypt, like, you have, like, a huge youth population.
Mm-hmm.
These youth population, they are mostly graduating from universities. They are highly skilled. They are very ambitious. They are very well connected with the rest of the world in social media.
Mm-hmm.
They are very good at using technologies. They speak foreign languages. So they become a very, very important and strategic asset that can actually build businesses to sell products and services all around the world. So right now, there are the business models that allows building businesses that works on the internet, or even like that uses the internet as a marketing channel for the products and services. So I think if we look at the Egyptian economy, and if we look at the youth and the potential that startups would happen, and actually around the region we have examples of countries that was able to create what they call the startup nation, is that like the whole university, all those graduating, they are actually starting businesses. So they are not the graduation project, for example, becomes an actual business. And we have some success stories of Egyptians who actually took their graduation project into becoming an actual business. So I think if we want to think about the Egyptian economy strategically,
mm-hmm.
given also the huge youth population that we have, we say that it becomes a startup nation. Let's go for a startup nation model. We want to empower these young people. We would like to give them access to the knowledge, to the tools, to the network. And we would like to evolve lots of the startups that would be able to kind of contribute to advancing Egypt itself, and also be able to sell and create economic value for the global economy and all around the world.
Now, what about the challenges facing young entrepreneurs in Egypt?
Well, there are plenty of that. And I would say that challenges are different from the step in which the business is emerging. So there are like one challenge that has to do with the experience and knowledge, is that to a lot of extent, the idea of starting your own business and a scalable business, mm-hmm. it's not something that's very popular. I mean, like we have the understanding of the classic business model of starting a shop, starting a like small business in a cookie cutter way. That's something that we really know how it works. But starting an innovative business with the potential to fail, I think there's a lot of learning when it comes to understanding the tools and the attitude about going into that. There are some cultural problems also, to be honest, like given what we talked about is that we're not used to this type of business. Mm-hmm. So when someone really say that I'm innovative and I'm starting a new business that do something we never heard about, so usually there's the attitude, okay, good luck, but there is, to a lot of extent, lack of belief. People are not going to put their money into these businesses. So like understanding that innovation or something with potential, this is also leaves quite a cultural challenge. As we move forward, we could find probably a challenge when it comes to the funding, is that if I built a business and I need to bump in more capital right now to scale the business, I think that the options are very, very limited at the current point in time. So lots of these startups, they have to offer services to rely on their cash flow to finance their expansion, which is a very exhausting process. Yes. And lots of worthy startups and worthy companies that could scale otherwise with external capital, it has to provide services that's not in the core to be able to attract the capital. So all these are challenges, and I think it becomes a matter of maturing, and here comes the endurance part. I think there are some very, very interesting stories for the ones who were able to make it, of how they actually went through downsizing, like some of the success stories that exist right now, mm-hmm. some of them went into 70% downsizing. So if they had a team of 20, they lost most of their team and they ended up like a small group, and most likely they had like delays in their salaries and lots of challenges, but they went through that. So they learned how to go through that. Okay. Another part is the flexibility of pivoting. Okay, I was intending to do that, but all right, let's say that this didn't work. So now like I say that this is we have the stigma around failure, mm-hmm. but so for me to confess that this didn't work, probably it might seem like I was saying that I was not smart enough at the beginning. So like, but for me to have the courage to say that this didn't work, it's time to pivot, and also to communicate this to the team around me and to even the parents, everyone who's looking at the startup, to do this pivot, also this becomes quite like a sharp change. So all these are challenges, but it comes down to the strength and endurance of the entrepreneur who's starting the process.
Okay, Mr. Abdelrahman, since we are running out of time, I have just one final question for you, if you would like to answer it briefly. You touched on a very important issue, which is funding. Perhaps this is an essential issue when it comes to entrepreneurship. Cool. How would young entrepreneurs convince investors with their ideas?
The good thing is that I'm writing a book about that. I'm writing a small book about that. Mm. And I think it comes down to a core belief in what they are doing, understanding of what investors are looking for, because you have to look at it from an investor standpoint. An investor would like to put right now 10,000 Egyptian pounds. In 1 year, it's going to be 100,000. Mm. So an investor is someone who puts 10,000 and he gets 10% of the company. After a year, the 10% of the company right now equals 100,000. So that's what he's thinking about. That one challenge is that entrepreneurs usually get there with the attitude is that this is my idea, I'm passionate about it, I'm going to talk to you about myself and my ideas and what you're doing. You have to think about it from the perspective of investors, is that I'm going to give you a stake in this company and this company to have the potential to grow. And in order for him to be able to communicate that, there are some hard skills and there are some soft skills. The hard skills comes into understanding the potential for scale, the potential for growth, and being able to calculate and kind of do this properly. And on the other hand, he has to communicate this and have the charisma to convince the investors that I am the qualified entrepreneur to tap into this market opportunity and to scale this company. So I think with the balance of the hard skills and the soft skills, if I'm convincing you right now with the facts and figures, and you see that I'm qualified enough, most likely you're going to put money on the table. So a balance between both of that, that's usually what gets entrepreneurs to raise funds.
Formula of success.
Yeah.
Okay. Mr. Abdulrahman Magdi, writer and entrepreneur, entrepreneur and expert, thank you very much
for
shedding light on this very important topic and coming today. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, indeed, thank you. And right now we will be having a report about the first Ramadan Olympics held at the Gezira Center for Youth, where hundreds of participants, tens of games took place, and all are or were actually winners, being fit, feeling healthy, and that's the main prize. And actually, to shed more light on that topic, we have with us our colleague Nirmin Abdulrahman in the following report.